Hi everybody, my name is Lisa Richmond, and I'm very excited to introduce our speaker today, Nada Cory. Nada was raised by her maternal grandparents in beautiful Croatia. She was raised on a farmstead, so there she became an integral part of her land and the people and all her family's protocol, all in the name of health and well-being. Those lessons learned have remained with her, and today she's able to teach and lecture on organic gardens, health and well-being subjects like healing, comforting through natural remedies. She's an amazing, sumptuous cook, which she makes beautiful things from the yield of her harvest. Nada also is a licensed medical assistant. She's certified in healing, Dha Gang Yoga, Reiki, essential oils, raindrop therapies. She's a philanthropist, entrepreneur, and a dream builder, life mastery coach. So, Nada, please continue.
Hey, thank you, Lisa. Thank you. Well, welcome to this beautiful big audience. The ones that can't see and the ones that can't. So there you go. My name is Nada Cory, and I'm the founder of the Joseph P Cory Foundation, which I founded officially 2015-16. But I have done health expos before that, like a decade before that, because my passion is all about health and well-being and prevention, because everything that we put into our body or on our body and expose ourselves to has an effect on our wellness. So helping people to understand that and becoming the stewards of their vessel and being the captains of that vessel is the key ingredient, because there's no magic pill or magic person that will do it for you. You have to do it yourself. So therefore, in order to share this message with as many people as possible, I created the foundation, and it consists of two components. One is a network of holistic and health practitioners and companies that are all into the well-being and natural ways of living, because that's what it is. It's not just one component, it's the whole lifestyle. And the other one is our healing gardens of hope, and working with children and people that want to learn how to grow their food and to grow their food, and then to understand what to do with it, how can you utilize it, what is the optimal use of their crop, and also what does it do in my body, how, so that you understand when to drink a chamomile tea or when to have peppermint tea, you know, because they have different effects on our body, like other things. One is a stimulant, one is a calmer, right? And you can say, sense that when you smell certain herbs, for example, or plants. They have a scent that they generate, and that scent we are breathing in, and through our olfactory factories, it goes into our brain and creates then the result in either calming or stimulating us. So that's just one component. I have learned that from early on, because I grew up, I was fortunate enough to grow up with my maternal parents' grandparents in rural Croatia, so on a farm, and that was my lifestyle. So being out in nature, climbing trees, eating the fruits from the trees, or picking the carrots from the garden was my normal thing to do, and interacting with animals and with nature in general. So there were a lot of things that I learned at that time just by doing it with my great-grandparents or grandparents and those around us that stuck with me. And I'm so grateful for them, because my grandmother would go out there, and if there was a tummy ache or something, and she would pick certain things, make a tea, you drink it, you rest, or go to sleep for an hour, and you wake up and it's all gone, it's all good. So that's my background. And I didn't think much of it until later on in life, when I had children of my own, and we found ourselves in certain situations where my child got sick. We were on an island, so you're out of your regular environment, so what you do, right? So luckily there was another woman, just like my grandmother, who knew exactly what to do, and she said, would you like to give him this tea to drink? It, you know, it might help. And certainly it did. I did it as well, because I got the same thing that he did, and it just worked like a charm very quickly, within an hour, you know, it just was amazing. So that's my background and my story. And now let's go to gardening. So I love gardening, and I can turn anything around me into growing something, whether it's a pot or maybe creating like a little garden bin or bed and plant something. Because that's how I grew up. So I know it's natural to me. And why is it so important to do that now more than ever? Because we're surrounded with so much of chemical stuff and so much of pesticides, and it's in the air, it's in the water, it's in our food. Our food is being GMO'd, has been, which means the seeds have been altered to either producing more crop, but also most of them, or pretty much I think every one of them, is already created so that it's ready to receive the pesticides. So it's asking for them, for that spray or whatever that chemical that is being put on. And therefore, if you grow your own garden, you know what you're doing with what you grow. You're not spraying it or giving it artificial stuff that you cannot even pronounce. And you learn how to listen to your plant or pay attention to what it's telling you, because there are signs all along the way which the plant uses to talk to us. They could be like veins showing, or they could be critters that are coming up, or the coloring of the leaves. They could be either, you know, pale, or they could be rich, and so on. So there are so many signs which we can learn about, and then we know that maybe the plant needs more nutrition, or is lacking water, or it has too much water, which will then create the plants to die or not to thrive. So, by the way, when we are planting and growing our own garden, we're actually addressing at least three of our needs. It's not just we're growing our food. We're using our body, our hands, and we are, in a way, creating movement and motion. So there is bending, or there is picking, you know, so you're doing certain motions. So it's movement. It's good for the body. We're breathing the fresh air. We're outside in nature. And we recreate an energetic relationship with the plant, because there's an energy that we generate, the plants generate. And they interact, because energy doesn't have any boundaries. So it's intermingling with each other. So it reads us. I've read a book about this woman who was talking about the importance of actually, before you plant your seed, this is funny, but it makes sense. You put them in your mouth, so it intermingles with your saliva, which tells the seed what your body needs, and then the plant will adjust in accordance to. It's a little far-fetched, but if you think about chemistry, there is chemistry here, literally. So the chemistry of the seed and the chemistry of our body is kind of connecting, and especially herbs, for example, right? So, well, that's just one example, but you can learn so much. There's so much out there. And there are so many ways of gardening. So, as I said, if you don't have a little spot, a little plot of land where you can plant, you can build a raised garden. So it's not very difficult to do. You just get, you know, these planks in whatever size you want to make it. You can raise it, or you can just secure a spot in the ground and just have the planks hold the soil in place, especially for us here in Florida, because we don't really have soil. It's all sand. So we have to build our soil from scratch, basically. And it is important to build it in accordance to the nutrition that the plant needs. So you would you can buy good organic soil, which already has some nutrients in it. What I have learned is that sometimes that becomes too dense, so you mix it with something like coconut scraps or coconut char or peat moss, which is not very expensive at all, and then some other nutrients that are minerals that you can also buy. So it's important to get compost is excellent. Absolutely, that's I do that as well. So you mix it all together, you create this brew in which then you plant. So the soil has to be kind of loose, not too sticky when you kind of clench it in your hand, so that it kind of, it doesn't dissipate, but it kind of holds together, but it doesn't stick together. So it's loose, so it's aerated. And then you can buy seedlings organic in some places. There are farmers markets where you can buy. We have a lot of farmers that are growing organic. You can connect to them and get some. I think we have a list, right, Lisa, where you can get these seedlings. If you don't want to plant your own seeds, and you start planting your seeds several weeks before you can plant in the ground, in the soil, or in the pot. And you do that. You can do that. Actually, there are seed planters where there are individual cups, and you fill them with that good soil for seeding, and then you put the little seed, one or two seeds in each spot. Just remember to have a double space above it, so not too deep and not too shallow. So it has to be double size of whatever the seed is. And then you water it and you keep it moist regularly. Don't saturate it, but keep it moist. Now you can even buy these trays, which I didn't bring, and I have it. I'm intending to bring it. So that have a container on the bottom, which you can fill with water. And then there's a tray that holds then the tray where you're planting separately from the water, so it's not sitting in water. And there is a mat that reaches into the water and constantly kind of pulls the water into the little seedling plants, which is awesome. But if you don't have that, and if you don't want to spend that money, you can just do egg cartons, you know, the paper egg cartons, so you can fill those with soil, and then you can put your seeds and just water them on a regular basis. And before you know it, your seeds will start to grow. When they are a couple inches high, you see that they are a little stronger, so that the natural environment doesn't just simply kind of break them down. Then you can put them in the pots, or you can put them in your little garden and tend to them properly. So make sure that before you plant, you have the nutrition components in the soil, and everything is good and ready to go. Yes.
What would you say are the advantages, we live in Florida, and disadvantages? So the advantages of Florida gardening, in your opinion, because a few people mentioned Lyme dye, so can you address that in terms of environmentally and being a Florida gardener?
Actually, it is great to live in Florida because we have pretty much all year round the capacity of growing, even though in the summer months we have to deal with extreme heat. Now, there are plants, there are indigenous plants that will grow during that period of time, so you can plant those during that time, or you can use the time to give your beds or your soil a rest, where you can cover it up with a gardening cloth, and that will keep, or plastic or something, right? So the heat will cook all the microbials inside underneath it and turn it into microbial free, but also healthy compost. So when the summer months are over in September, is here, you can start now with preparing your soil again and planting. At this time of the year, from October through March, is optimal time for growing, especially these first 3-4 months. So it's really great.
So
and with water, you have to make, if you have a bin or raised bed, and obviously your soil and your plants are sitting in a bin, you have to make sure that there is enough drainage, because we get a lot of rains as well in our rainy season. So what I do in the pot, you can drill some holes so that they can, that the water can drain out, or you can put rocks on the bottom, you know, and give it space so that it can drain like that. So you see, you just have to pay attention to what's going on around you and what's going on with your plant. It should not be dry, but it should not also be saturated, because it will rot, the roots will rot. Okay, so did that?
So basically I would say, if I had a calendar in June, July, and August, maybe I'm not gardening, maybe I have my soil covered up and I'm working on my compost. September, I might be starting seedlings so that by October, maybe they're ready to go into the ground. And would that be a good calendar for a garden?
Yes.
I heard of something called adaption. So if I grew my little seedlings on my back porch, but then I wanted to put them somewhere in the sun, would I have to start the very finicky, gradually moving them towards that? Yes, I would have to. Don't want to shock them, right? Is that it?
Exactly. Yeah. It's just like having a baby, right? Would you expose the baby to full sun, or would you gradually introduce it to its skin, right? So you're literally dealing with a baby plant. So it is more fragile and needs more protection. So don't put it out there where the wind, you know, will break it or the sun will burn it. So just remember, it is a new growth and it needs protection. So don't put it in the bright sun, but it does need light.
You mentioned organic and non-GMO. There's a flyer in our bag, and I once bought non-GMO seeds, and I only eat certified organic, and I thought, oh, that's great. You know, they're gonna be great, healthy seeds, but when I looked at this list that you once gave, I realized that, look at that list on the bottom, non-GMO is sort of what you said, they don't alter the seeds, but it looks like they still use antibiotics, growth hormones, artificial colors, preservatives, so fertilizers, pesticides. So I'm thinking non-GMO isn't really where I want to be. I would rather pick either seeds that say, right, certified organic, and then on the sustainable seeds, are they okay? Things that are grown locally, that's okay? Yeah.
Yeah, I would go with locally grown, because you can't go much wrong with that, because it's proven, right? They've proven themselves. And actually, you can harvest your own seeds. Like, let's say from a tomato or a pumpkin or a melon, watermelon, any melon. So if you buy an organic non-GMO produce, and let's say a cantaloupe, you cut it in half and you scoop out the middle, right? You've probably done that before, right? And you separate the little seeds from the fleshy part, you let it dry, and then you have your own seed, which you can then plant in your garden eventually. So with a tomato, you can get a nice heirloom tomato from a local grower, or somebody maybe that you can do it themselves. And if you cut the slices and you poke out the little seeds, you have your seed for your tomato. Okay? So there's lots of ways how to do that. But there are places where you can buy organic non-GMO seeds, which I would say is important, as Lisa mentioned before. It's not just enough to grow it organic, but also to keep your seeds non-GMO.
sad that.
I have a really small area, but I'm looking at these posters that you put up here, and one says microgreens, and it's like, and one says tower garden. That looks really interesting to me. What is that?
Okay. Well, microgreens, there are certain plants like sunflower seeds or radishes, or there's a variety of them that you can simply grow in a dish, and you can put a little bit of soil or something in there, a little bit of soil, and you put the seeds in, and you let them grow to a couple of inches, and you simply cut them and put them on your salad. What you have here is high nutrition. That's going to be in our next class, because we're going to be talking about that. So the amino acids, everything is going to be optimal, and it's so easy to grow. You can they sell different kinds of dishes and towers where you can grow them, or just in a kind of a bin. Very easy to grow. Again, you're not exposing it to sun too much or heat or rain. So you're keeping it somewhere where you can control the environment. But we are very lucky that we can grow them outside here. You know, in up north or somewhere else where it's now cold, they have to have the greenhouses for them. A lot of facilities or healing facilities, they grow also wheatgrass. So you can cut the wheatgrass and you juice it, and it's highly, highly nutritious as well. So that's that. And tower garden. There are tower gardens. I have connections to some of the people that are that have either created such a thing or are using it. And what it is a tower that that consists of trays which are built upon each other. You fill them with soil, and then you plant your seedlings. A lot of them have irrigation system that you can put in, and it will give it the water that it requires. And in the irrigation pond, you can actually put the nutrients, liquid nutrients, wormwood and whatever else in there, and it will automatically nourish the plants. And it looks very pretty. So, and a lot of them, you can put them on some kind of trolley or, you know, wheels, and you can wheel it around. You know, you can keep it in this corner, or you can bring it inside, or, you know, it's so for the tower garden, it doesn't matter whether you live in Florida or not, you can do that anywhere, because you can grow it indoors as well. And you just go and pick. And you know, the optimal nutrition is when you pick the plant, you harvest, and you can eat it right away. That's the optimal nutrition. When it sits around, like when you're buying it in the store, it travels from who knows where, and it's been on that truck or in some cooling facility for a bit, it has lost most of its nutrition. So you think you're doing a lot of good, but actually it's not that much in there anymore. So gardening is the key. Yes.
So we're ready to plant, so.
So do you have any questions?
Yeah. How often do you have to like change out like the soil, like replenish it, like to make sure that there's enough nutrients?
Well, I would say every year I would add nutrients to it, but also some nutrition every 3 months. Mm-hmm. And there are liquid form, or you can make it into a liquid form. We buy them, and we have maybe a list. If we don't, we will provide the list of what you can put in there. It about takes 3 months for the plants to utilize what is there. There is one great thing which I have learned recently. If you get charcoal, coconut charcoal in particular, and mix it into the soil, so the charcoal is like a sponge that has little holes in it, and it will keep the nutrients for a longer period of time so that the plants can grow from it. Otherwise, if you water too much or whatever, it rains too much or whatever, it's going to flush out. So that is a very important component. So
Amazon always says, what's in the box? So what's in the bag? What do we have in the bag that we can start? Do you have, yes, everyone have their bags?
Yes. tokens, right? Yep. How to do that. And if you go to our website, josephpcoryfoundation.org, and sign up, you will receive our newsletters, and every newsletter will bring some new things, some new information to you. So this is what we've created for the kids, but anybody can benefit from it. And then, what do we have here?
Well, that's just some information about us.
This is some information about the foundation and what I've talked about already. But here you got a cup. And
seeds.
And some seeds as well. Okay. So you'll have everything here so you can plant something today.
There is a green napkin in there, and you can use that as a placemat, but careful when you open it. There's some decorative, we can decorate our pots with something in that. Open it up. Glenn, just take it, open it up. Take the whole thing.
There, in your green napkin.
Okay.
You have some pretty little thingies that you can decorate with that Lisa has beautifully put together.
There's some glue and a stick because we can decorate our pot. We may not be putting the seeds in our mouth, or we could, but we will have. But by decorating our pot, we're really creating a personal relationship with our pot.
And then we have, of course, a bag of soil. We have a paper cup.
That soil, you may want to explain that that was from Farmer Jack, so you know what's inside of that soil. And
yes.
I added some, talk about the seed soil.
Yes. So this is already a pre-mixed soil that we have purchased from Farmer Jay, who is a master gardener, a local master gardener, and does some gardens like at the Breakers, at the farmhouse, farmer's table, in some schools, and so on. Anyways, and we have enriched it with some nutrients and
seedling starter.
So
kind of gives it a little
perfect.
Like formula for a baby.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you want to take the cup solely and that little stick and that little cup of glue, you can glue some of those little cutie things on there while we just talk a little bit more and get that pot ready.
So
on that cup, I want you to look on the cup. There's a sticker on that cup, and it says, does somebody want to read that? What that sticker says on there on the back of the cup? There's
a nation
a quote.
That destroys its soils destroys itself.
Teddy Roosevelt. So
yep.
Teddy Roosevelt was one of the most powerful voices in the history of American conservation. At an early age, he was really enthralled by nature, and he cherished and he promoted our nature's landscape and its wildlife. And after becoming the president in 1901, he used his authority to establish 150 national forests, 51 federal bird reserves, 4 national game preserves, 5 national parks, and 18 national monuments, over 230 million acres of public land. But I bet that you knew that since you are a Parks and Rec.
I knew that.
You did know that. Okay, that is very good. So today, Theodore Roosevelt's legacy is found, you know, across the country, and we could thank him because we get to see beautiful things. There are 6 national parks that are dedicated in part or whole to to our president. And along with, I don't know if anyone ever went to Muir Woods, along with John Muir and Rachel Carson, Theodore Roosevelt's words and actions continue to affect how we approach and appreciate the natural world. So here's someone in a position of authority that looked around and thought there's something that he can do that will truly affect the future of people's lifestyle and health and well-being. So, yeah, we could decorate our little pot right now, and or you could save it for later. It's up to you if you want to glue it on later.
This is glue?
That's glue. That's a glue stick. Remember, we share this with our schools well. And there's a glove, I think, even in there if you don't want to get your hand dirty. Just take
and then you have the soil. You can put that in your cup.
Give it maybe it'll keep it from blowing over.
And do you use all the soil?
I would save about an inch because when we plant, Nada's going to tell you once you put the seed in, we're going to need a little bit of extra soil.
If you put all of it in, it only comes out to about an inch from the top anyway.
Yeah, exactly. And if you water it, it's going to also
It'll condense.
Exactly.
And actually, we have our, we can spritz down their seed.
And we have some bean seeds here. So you can actually plant at least two of them. You can plant three of them because they can be then separated when you're planting them in your garden or in a bigger pot once they grow.
You could use a comparison. The cup with two seeds could be a test market to the soil that you have on the ground to see if you amended it, if it grew directly, you know, from the earth up to you. Does anyone like beans? Do you eat beans?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like black beans.
Ooh.
Pinto beans.
You gave me seeds for black
beans. You can make hummus. I mean, our chef class is going to be amazing, but grow something before we get there.
Yeah, just a little something. So
how big do these like little bean bushes get?
You ever hear of Jack and the Beanstalk? Get your sneakers ready. No. those beans, did I write it on the seed? Those are bush beans. There are beans that grow
like
on a bush versus a vine, so you don't need to have this next to a trellis. They get to about maybe 18 inches to high.
Yeah, not very high.
Not that high, but they're very productive, and when you pick them off, you'll keep seeing little flowers. You know, they go for maybe one bush a couple of weeks, you can still keep, you know, picking the beans off. It's the gift that keeps on giving.
And they should grow, the seedlings should grow pretty quickly, so you will see little seedlings.
Take photos with your camera.
Yes,
you can do an age, you can do a time lapse. Actually, I put those seeds in one of those biodegradable tiny, tiny little cups, and then I had it out in the sun and I was spritzing it like two times a day. I'd say within 2 days it was out of the soil. In 3 days it was like, I have some videos of that. We gave that to a little child. Like within 3 days it was like 2 inches tall.
Yeah.
I mean, the kid was like totally amazed, and you know, we kind of hyped up the Jack and the Beanstalk story.
Yes.
And I think within a week I actually put it in the soil because it outgrew its home.
I did too.
You could put that little biodegradable cup into a bigger cup and then move it, and then I just moved it to where I was going to plant it, you know, ultimately.
See, that's the good thing if you plant your seedlings in
you're missing something.
Paper.
I had a couple of leaves that I think
I have more. It's fall, that's why they blew away. Okay.
Now, I have dogs, so
I'm going to give you leaves.
Safe, like if they accidentally ingest it. I know, like, there's some things that are not safe for dogs. What do you mean, the plant?
But sometimes it just doesn't take. Actually, there's a chart over here. It's called the Seed Life Cheat Sheet. So it lists the vegetables and the herbs, and it tells you the shelf life of your seeds. When you buy a packet of seeds, sometimes there's 1,000 in there, not, 100. Sometimes there's 24, but you use them, and let's say you planted beans, and then you want to rotate your crop. Say, I don't want everything that I grow to be ready like in a month and a half. I would like maybe in 2 months other things come up, 3 months, so you can alternate them. And once you plant some, you can keep them in a cool, dry place and use them again and again. Like, for example, these are beans. So the shelf life of beans, the bean seeds, are 3 years. So technically, I could take them out next year if I didn't use them, and I can use them again. So
And you can actually save some seeds, some beans, if you let them dry on the bush. And when they're dry, they're, you take them and keep them in a dry spot, and you can plant the next year. So, you know, if you don't eat all of them, you can plant some of them. And since we have been gifted with some of the pumpkin seeds, I still have some pumpkin seeds, so you can have a whole pumpkin.
I found my
family. Okay, wait, wait, wait. Beautiful job.
We have a number of rabbits in the neighborhood. How do you prevent the rabbits from eating your
garden? Those wacky rabbits.
Yeah.
So what are some of the things, because we work on different properties. There have been, like, Parks and Rec, they have put up, I'll call, like a kind of a wire.
Yeah, a chicken wire fence.
Like on a hinge, like just say you did a little box garden on a hinge, like a kind of a cage that comes up and down to keep critters out. I noticed personally, I have different levels in my garden, and the higher up, like it seems to, no one's going to take the effort to go that high.
Yeah.
Does anyone live near iguanas, have like big giant iguanas?
Yeah, we have some, not in abundance.
That's good.
We have some.
Iguanas seem to like to
they
do a little dab.
They can climb anywhere, yeah, for sure. But if you create like a dome with that chicken wire or something, you know,
I don't think they would get in.
They can't get in.
We're not advocating electrical fences or anything like that. But you know, some we were during the time frame when it was raining and really windy a couple weeks ago. A lot of people started their garden because, oh good, it's after hurricane season, it's after November 1st. And then we were hit with global warming issues, right? So that being said, everyone on this, on Facebook, there's a really nice site called South Florida Edible Gardeners. And you can ask a question or say, what's this stuff that's growing on my plant? And in 5 seconds, someone will say, oh, that's mange. Oh, I don't really know what it is, but still. So it's very helpful. So people were saying, oh, I planted this stuff and the rain just totally took it away. And someone put a quote up there or said, you know, everything has to live. So, you know, it's a cycle and it's part of nature, and whether a little chameleon bites your leaves a little bit, I mean, it's hungry, it has to eat, so it's really part of the, you know, the Lion King, the circle of life, and you can't get too bent out of shape, not to mention, you know, mind, body, spirit for gardening. So if just going out there makes you feel that great and happy, you know, when you have endorphins and you're healing yourself from the inside out, I mean, maybe that's the reason why you're gardening, you know, so.
You know, I saw this video, I think it was on the Dodo this guy who was like a really intense gardener. He had this like amazing garden that he kept up, and he noticed that every morning everything would be eaten.
Very proud.
Yeah, he's so nice.
Okay, ready? Want to hold it up? Thanks.
You know, they are companion planting, so there are plants that animals do not like that much because they're very potent. So that's particularly herbs that are like garlic or chives, garlic chives or onion chives. They are strong.
Oregano.
So yeah, oregano, exactly. They wouldn't go for that. So if you have something that you want to protect, put those on the outside and put the gentler plants inside, like lettuces or basil or things like that that they might. And there's also different kinds of basil and herbs that, you know, you can plant. Some are growing better in one season and some are better in another one. So
making pesto, and you just never know where your life is going to take you, right? Because basil is your thing. By the way, Amazon.com has very interesting selection of things and very amazing products that if you don't want to be the person to have to go to Home Depot and carry a giant bag of something, they will. If you have Prime, they will just ship it to your door. If Nana, for example, said that the perfect cocktail for soil was one-third peat, one-third coconut core, and one-third organic soil, you know, you could go on there, click those three things, and then the next day you have what you need. So organic soil seeds as well, and tower gardens, and everything like that. And also you mentioned that we have a list of green markets in Palm Beach County and that have sustainable, organic, great produce, and you're supporting the
local
culture.
Local businesses, yes, absolutely. I'm always for that because we want to enhance our community, right? So this is it. If you have any questions.
We have a little green market right down the street from where we live on Military.
Yeah.
Well, that's Boys.
Okay.
Boys is a big one.
Mm-hmm.
Boys has everything. But then there's a small local market that's on the other side of the street that's a little bit closer to us.
Oh, okay.
I don't remember the name of it.
I don't remember either. But yeah, that's a good
I have a question. Nana, is it?
Yes.
Have you studied Ayurvedic medicine?
Namaste. I've been a TM meditator for like almost 30 years.
And you look familiar. I think I've met you somewhere.
Mike
Scazzari. Have you ever been to iYoga in Delray?
No, but as a meditator, I've been on a lot of courses, and Mike Scazzari was my TM teacher. So it's possible. I've been in the community since 1977. So in some incarnation, perhaps. But back to Ayurvedic, what were you thinking?
No, because a lot of what she was telling us about using different herbs for medicinal purposes is all grounded.
So don't you think,
Mana,
every place has
we
its...
Yes, we do. I have been studying that world for quite some time, especially once I woke up and realized where I grew up and what I learned when I was little, and then I've been
that is, it's all grounded in from, yes, you know, from 3,000 years ago in India.
Exactly. But we also have in our network of holistic practitioners, we have a lot of practitioners that are in that field, so they utilize. We have Farsi herbs. Dr. Ari, she practices ancient Persian medicine, which is very much like Ayurveda. And she is the sixth generation in the field, in her family, of such practitioners. It's all about wellbeing, being their medicine. Mm-hmm. So she's truly a master, and she's affiliated with us, and hopefully we will bring her and she will talk in one of our events. Especially we will bring them all together in our healies once that is happening, which is a healthy lifestyle symposium that we are working on to create. It should have happened in April, but maybe next April, I don't know, yeah, we'll see.
Across the street, at the South County.
Yeah, exactly, that's what we're planning, so there will be a lot
symposium
of them present there. And she's just one of them. There's a lot of others that are working with Chinese medicine and general. So, yes, I am very familiar.
So, because Nada does these wonderful entrepreneurial things as well, we were talking to Erin, we're going to have our little raffle right now, and what we're raffling off is Ultimate Germ Shield Gel. So, why don't you just talk a little bit about that, because it has something to do with what Glenn said, and even the Wata.
Yes. Okay, see, my other company is Nadona International, and you can find that online as well. You can have a card here, but whoever's going to win this is going to have it in there. So, about a year or so ago, I have been asked by a friend who has a home health care facility in Canada, and her company was celebrating anniversary, and she said, Anna, can you create something that is like the antimicrobial, bacterial, and so on, gel, like some of the other companies have? Can you create something that has all these organic essential oils and herbs in it for me? And I would love to give that, you know, as a memento for the celebration. So I called my connection to Farsi Herbs, Dr. Chakari, and I said, do you think we can do this? And she says, as a matter of fact, I already have the recipe. And that's how the Ultimate Germ Shield has been created. And it comes in three different forms. So one of them is a gel, which has essential oils that are known to combat any kind of microbials and so on, many other things. So, and the base is gel, aloe gel, aloe vera gel, which is healing in itself, as you know. We're using it for burns and stuff on the skin. It soothes the skin. So,
and it'll actually grow in our soil.
Exactly.
Very well.
So you don't need much because it is concentrated. You just take like a little dab of that, and you can feel how gentle it is. So any kind of skin condition or issue is okay, because it doesn't have alcohol that burns the skin and actually takes away the protective layer that is naturally on our skin. There is
especially if you're using it 10 times a day.
Exactly. And the good thing is that what I do with it, I actually can put it up my nose, especially if I'm traveling or being somewhere indoors, you know, where the air is dry. So it will moisturize the membrane, but the oils will protect from whatever I'm breathing in that shouldn't be going in. So and we have it in a spray form as well. So this has aloe water, including also ionized water in there. So you can spray it on you, you can spray it in you, you can spray it on the surfaces. It smells good, and it's very gentle, calming, and there is another one which I didn't bring, which is a roller. It's an oil, just pure essential oils, which you can roll if you have some tension or if you're upset at some point, and it will calm you down and soothe the tension. So
hard to choose. Maybe we have a consolation prize.
Maybe we have a consolation prize. So, anyway, so this is what we're giving away today. And so my company, Nadona International, is has created these products. We also have a powder that is like a protein powder, which are freeze-dried fruits and vegetables. And 50% of it is moringa. Moringa changes and heals the gut. Malnutritional areas, like you know, where you have malnutrition children in Africa, so they've grown the moringa and they crush the leaves and they sprinkle it over the rice because they have nothing else as nutrition. So it's highly nutritious and it heals the gut. So we have that powder as well. Anyway, so that's enough of that. You can learn more about that on the site.
So the moringa heals the gut, it's like it has probiotics or,
yeah. It's like you would eat the fruit and the vegetable and those herbs naturally, but it's freeze dried. That means it contains all the nutrients. They are not destroyed in eating it or something. So it's freeze dried. So it's good freeze. And it's like a powder. And you can just mix it with water.
This
and I'm
crazy.
Sorry I didn't bring it with me, but I'm learning. Next time I will have some.
All right, here, write your names on here, and then we'll fold them up and pick them.
And what do we have? We also have our t-shirts for the foundation and the Gardens of Hope, which we use for our volunteers when we do gardening at the schools or at the Riverbend Park or wherever we have a garden.
Okay, we'll fold it in quarters or everyone do the same. All right, we'll put them in here. Okay. Okay. Better and exceed our expectations and yours as well. So,
yes.
So hopefully we'll see everyone. It's the third Thursday. I think it's December 17th.
Yeah.
And again, you have to register because we still only have 10 spots per. So thank you so much.
Yeah. Share the good news with others.
I put other suggestions for improvement last week.
Less wind.
And there you go. Mother Nature has its own plans. You know, like man plans, Mother Nature laughs.
Yeah. Thank you.
It could have been 95 out.
Oh.
That wouldn't have been too pleasant.
No, it's nice, like outdoor air.